next part of this module is about the theory of covering spaces, which is an incredibly important part of algebraic topology. In particular, as a part of this section of the course, we will prove that pi 1 of the circle is the integers, which is long overdue a proof. We've been assuming that for a long time. In this video, I'd like to give you some intuition for what a covering space is, working towards the formal definition. So I want to start with an example. So let's take the space C, complex numbers, minus the origin. And let's consider the map from this space to itself, which I'm going to call P, that takes a complex number and squares it. What do we know about this map? Well, it's surjective. Every number has a square root. And in fact, every number apart from zero has exactly two square roots. That's actually why I removed zero, so that this would be true. It's a 2-to-1 map. It's not injective. 2 points mapped down to 1 point. Nonetheless, even though it's not injective, we can try and define an inverse. That's why we have a function called the square root. The point is we actually have two square root functions, so we actually have two. And they differ by a sign. So, more precisely, what do I mean? If I take the complex numbers without the origin, that's the origin, I'm getting rid of it, and I cut out a whole half line going off from the origin to minus infinity along the x-axis, let's call that B, a branch cut, then on C minus this branch cut, we have Q plus and Q minus, two functions which are kind of inverses in the sense that if we take the square root and then square it, we get back to the same thing. So in this particular example, or in this particular case, this won't be true in general for covering maps, Q minus is minus Q plus. So for example, Q plus of 1 is the positive square root of 1, that's 1, and Q minus of 1 is minus 1. It's also a square root of 1. Now we could have equally taken a branch cut going out the other way. And done the same kind of thing, and we'd have got another set of what's called local inverses for this square function. And the point of taking this branch cut is we start with something non-simply connected. So C minus the origin is not simply connected. It's got this hole in the middle. We've not proved this yet, right? This is something that's going to be proved later. But C minus the branch cut is simply connected. Right, if I take out the branch cut, actually what's left is simply connected, there's no holes in it. And this is actually why we can define this inverse on the complement of the branch cut. Similar example, if you take the logarithm instead of the square root, you can do something similar. So let's take C, just all of C now, mapping to, again, C minus the origin, sending Z to e to the Z. Maybe this should be e to the iz. So this is, again, surjective, because any number has a logarithm except zero. And, okay, it's not 2 to 1 anymore, it's not injective, it's actually infinite to 1. Any point has infinitely many pre-images because e to the I z plus 2 pi times any integer equals e to the I z. So there's infinitely many pre-images that differ by a translation. Here's C. So this point, which is 2 pi, 4 pi, these all map to the same point in C minus the origin, which is namely 1. Nonetheless, we can play a similar trick, make a branch cut and define an inverse, and this time we get infinitely many inverses. So on C minus a branch cut, we have what I'll call log, I probably shouldn't call it log subscript n because that means like log to the base n. So I'll just call it what it is, right? It's the usual log plus 2 pi I n going from C minus the branch cut back to C, such that, so maybe I should call this Qn. This is a function Qn, just like the inverses here were called Q plus and Q minus. So such that if I take exp, this map is called P, exp of log of Z, I get Z. This is saying exp log Z plus 2 pi I n equals Z. That's all this equation is saying. Right, so this is very similar to the case of the square and the square roots. In that case, it was a 2 to 1 map, so we had two pre-images defined on the complement of a branch cut, and they satisfied this equation, which said the square of a square root is the thing you started with. And here, we've got infinitely many inverses defined on the complement of a branch cut, and they all satisfy this equation that says exp of log is the identity. And roughly speaking, a covering map something like this. So it's a map which is n to 1 for some n, possibly infinity, and which has n local inverses defined on simply connected subsets of the domain, of the target rather. So in other words, if it's a map P from X to Y, just give you consistency with the notes, I think I better call this Y to X. Then you have inverses Q going from some subset U to Y, such that P of Q of Z equals Z for all Z in U. And the thing to notice here is, in this second example, the domain of this covering map is the complex numbers, that's simply connected. And the pre-images, the inverses, right, are indexed by the integers. So the QNs are indexed by Z. And that's roughly speaking how you deduce that the thing downstairs has fundamental group Z. Okay, so I want to start doing this rigorously now instead of just giving you vague ideas. So let's make a definition. Let P be a map from some space Y to some space X. So first of all, a subset U in X is called an elementary neighborhood if there is a discrete set F and a homeomorphism. I promise I'll tell you what all these things have to do with what I've just been saying. A homeomorphism H going the pre-image P inverse of U to U times F, such that, so let me just draw a picture. This has a projection down to U, which is P. This has a projection down to U, which is just the projection onto the first factor. And I want this diagram to commute. In other words, if I go from here down via P, that's P restricted to this subset. That's the same as going along, followed by going down the projection. Right, what has this definition got to do with anything I just said? Well, elementary neighborhoods, these are these guys I was calling U in the previous line. You should think of this as like the complement of a branch cut. This is the subset on which you have a locally defined inverse. Well, actually, you have many locally defined inverses, and they're parameterized by this discrete set. What's that? Well, in the first example, the discrete set for the square root function is the set sort of plus or minus one, just 2 points. In the second example, that discrete set was the integers. And what are these local inverses? So from this, we get for each point little f in this discrete set a map Q subscript f. Actually, maybe I shouldn't call this f. F, you always think f being a function, right? So let's call that point something else. Let's call it M. So QM going from U first to U times F which is sending a point x to x comma m, and then from u times f backwards along this homeomorphism, which is possible because it's a homeomorphism, so it's invertible, to p inverse u. Right, so this is a fancy way of saying we can find some region which is like the complement of a branch cut, and for each element of some discrete set we can find an inverse for P that goes on that set, that elementary set, it goes first to U times this discrete set and then across via the inverse of this homeomorphism to P inverse U. That's what's behind this definition. Next, we say P is a covering map if X is covered, and this is the first instance of this that we're going to encounter, but it's going to be ubiquitous. This word cover just means like covered by open sets, as in you have open sets that contain every point. This is covering in the sense of the definition I'm making here. So the two words mean different things. So if X is covered by elementary neighborhoods, I'm just going to write NBHD for neighborhoods. So in other words, this is saying every point in X is contained in the complement of some branch cut for which you have these locally defined inverses. And that's exactly what I said up here, that you know, for the square root you can either take the branch cut going in the negative X direction or in the positive X direction or in any direction you like. The same is true in the exponential case. Okay, I'm going to introduce one more piece of notation or definition. We're going to say that a subset of Y is an elementary sheet. This is going to be helpful to have this terminology later. If, it's going to be path connected. And P of V is an elementary neighborhood. So how should you think of this? Well, let me get a new page. Here's a picture of the exponential map. And I'm just going to restrict for simplicity to the unit complex numbers, so the circle inside C star, just because it's very hard to draw otherwise. So, you know, upstairs we have the real numbers inside C, and they're mapping via this map P to the unit complex numbers, because the map P was P of x equals e to the I x. So if you start with something real, you end up in the unit complex numbers. And the point is that, you know, 0 goes to 1 because e to the 0 is 1, but so does 2 pi, so does 4 pi, 6 pi, etc., and all the negatives, multiples of 2 pi as well. They all live over the point 1, and the points minus pi, pi, 3 pi, etc. all project down to minus 1. And so you have this kind of cyclic picture. of like a helix living over the circle. This is how you should visualize a covering map. So here is an elementary set. Right. So the branch cut that we made went in the negative direction. So everything except the number minus one is going to give us our elementary neighborhood. And the sheets that I'm talking about are something like this. Right, that's a path connected subset in the total space of the covering map, which projects down to this elementary neighborhood down here. And you can see there are infinitely many sheets in this example. That's another sheet. This is another sheet. And I'm calling them sheets because they kind of look like sheets that live over, many sheets living over one thing downstairs. So these guys are the elementary sheets. This is the elementary neighborhood. So here are some more examples of covering spaces of the circle. Right, so I've just drawn one, this sort of infinite cover where the domain is R and the map is like exponentiation. But another example would be the first one we saw, where you take the square root, or sorry, the square function. So 1 projects to 1 under z go to z squared, but also minus 1 projects to 1, and I projects to minus 1, and minus I also projects to minus 1. So this is a map from the unit circle, right? It's taking e to the I x to e to the I 2x. So it's taking the unit circle to the unit circle. It's sending 1 to 1, minus 1 to 1, I to minus 1, minus I to minus 1, etc. So this is a double cover. But you know, there's nothing special about the number 2. We could have picked any n here. So let's just draw the case n equals 3. Let me try that again. Roughly speaking, so this point down here has 1, 2, 3 pre-images, which are now going to be 1 e to the I 2 pi over 3, e to the I 4 pi over 3, and the map is z goes to z cubed, and again over minus 1 I have 3 pre-images, and you can figure out what they are for yourself. So this is a 3 to 1 cover. So let's call this one P2 and this one P3. So more generally, we have Pn for any n. And we also have P infinity, which is the one going from R to S1. Let's just have a look at some examples of covering spaces of something that's not the circle. Let's take the figure 8. And actually, this is going to be an incredibly important example in what follows, because its fundamental group is so complicated, it's going to have lots of covering spaces. So let me colour it in. So this loop is red and this one is blue. Let me put arrows on them as well, just for fun. So I claim that the following is a covering space of the figure 8. So let's see, this point, the x in the middle, this cross point, is gonna be a double cover, so that's gonna have 2 pre-images. this red arc here is going to have two pre-images, and maybe I could take them to be this one and this one. And this blue arc is going to have two pre-images, and maybe I could take them to be this one and this one. Now, these arrows don't mean that I'm making identifications and gluing stuff. They just indicate some directions on these. They'll be useful for keeping track of things later. So don't imagine that I'm gluing these two together. I'm not. So this is a covering space. What is the covering map? Well, this point here is going to this point here. This point here is again going to the central point of the figure eight. The points on each red edge are mapping to the points on this red edge, and they're doing so in such a way that you know, if you move time t along this red edge in the direction shown by the arrow, then you project down to the point that's distance t along this edge in the direction of the arrow. Similarly for the blue guys, they're mapping down to this blue loop. So that's a 2-to-1 cover. Here's another 2-to-1 cover. I could do the same thing but with the red and blue reversed. Right, so these could be blue. These could be red. Gives me another covering space. You might like to think, are there any more 2-to-1 covers of the figure eight? Or are these the only two? Okay, so in the next video we will see some more theory about covering spaces. We will define path lifting and monodromy, and we'll eventually get to the point where we can prove that the fundamental group of the circle is the integers.